Thank you for listening to KSO Today, your free daily podcast from K-State Online. We'll talk Kansas State football, basketball, recruiting, and everything going on at KSO, your rivals.com home for Kansas State athletics. This podcast will move rather quickly, so let's not waste any more time in kicking off another installment of KSO Today. Welcome to another week, and specifically another Monday of KSO Today, as it is Monday, January 20th, here in the year of 2020. Kansas State surprised many, most certainly me, last Saturday in Manhattan by blowing out number 12 West Virginia, 84-68, in Bramlage Coliseum for the Wildcats' first Big 12 win of the season. That game, of course, will be the focus of today's episode, but I want to get in a quick mention of our sponsors, People's State Bank and Legacy Insurance, before we really get going here. As you may well know by now, PSB has 10 branch locations and 17 ATMs located throughout the state, including 6 ATMs here in Manhattan alone. And you can check out the Legacy Insurance website at LegacySolutionsKS.com. Before I really dive deep into that West Virginia win and spend kind of the rest of our time there, a brief look around everything we've ran on the site, well, most everything, since I came to you last Friday for KSO Today. This morning, Derek Young shared a pretty nice update on a class of 2021 wide receiver out of Ankeny, Iowa, who's been offered Brody Brecht, 6'4", a bigger target. He already has a lot of good offers. Certainly a prospect worth watching. There'll be a lot of fighting for him, too. Flando's report card off the win has been fun to read. I think Flando's pretty darn good at this. Some people have felt like these grades are a little harsh, and they may err on that side, but I probably respect him doing that more than the other. But it was one where you could have bumped it up here and there for sure. I think he does a great job. You can read that and see if you agree or disagree with what Flando's numbers were there. Of course, video, highlights, full highlights, and the press conference. I tell people, if you don't watch those highlights from Flando, they're pretty fun because where his camera, you know, his shot is seated is typically right, almost basically right on the K-State bench. So the best part of the video to me is just sitting there and listening for comments from the coaches, players, that kind of stuff during shots or during plays, more than watching the highlights themselves. But he does a great job on that. And of course, a full video of Bruce Weber, Cartier, Jada. Let's see who else was there. Dejuan Gordon, David Sloan, all speaking after the game. And one from Derek Young. He writes these after every game, just a different perspective than, you know, our regular basketball staff shares. And his was really interesting on perhaps how confident K-State looked against West Virginia and how he saw that spread throughout the game. We, of course, have a photo gallery up from the game like we do every time. This one also might be a little more interesting than most. If you click through it, you will see pictures of Casey Eziagu, the UTEP transfer who's already part of the K-State program. You'll also see pictures of visitors Sekou Gassama from the class of 2021 and then four-star 2020 recruit Donovan Williams, who also got offered by K-State this weekend. Flanders saw both those guys, had brief, you know, conversations with them. There will be updates coming, I'm sure, on the site from them as well. We have an update, really, just from K-State. We appreciate them sending it out on Eziagu signing a scholarship agreement that has some quotes from Bruce Weber that are fun to read and interesting. Of course, there was a Hoops recruiting notebook released after Friday's KSO Today came out. And then perhaps most interesting, we did release an off-the-record late Friday afternoon, early Friday evening. That's something, if you haven't read, I think still has some shelf life you can go look at. So that's everything we've kind of had, I think, since the last time we talked on Friday and the last KSO Today. Now I want to spend a good bulk of time talking, of course, about this West Virginia game. I had K-State losing it. I think I picked K-State to lose 59-51. K-State scores 84 points in this game, so that's how far off I was. I always steal a lot of these stats and thoughts from KSU underscore fan throughout my basketball coverage, so credit to him on this number, too. I'm just going to read out a word-for-word tweet he sent out right after the game. K-State had its second-best offensive efficiency and shooting game this year. So second-best. Number one was that Alabama State game, a really, really bad team. So second-best offensive efficiency and shooting game this year against what was the number one efficiency defense and number one e-field goal defense in the nation in West Virginia. So, in more layman terms, K-State had its best offensive game of the year, considering the competition, that also came against the best defense in college basketball. So that's kind of how fascinating this performance was for K-State. Let me go down the stat line and just go player by player to talk through all the Wildcats. I think it's an interesting way to do it. Cartier Jada deserves, I think, first comment for sure. The junior played 38 minutes, scored 25 points, 6 boards, 4 assists, 2 steals, had a plus-minus, again, a flawed stat. I don't like to bring that up a lot, but it is interesting, of a plus-12, which is very good. Seven turnovers is where it comes back on Cardi on this game for sure. He was very good. K-State does not win this game in the manner it does without Cardi Ejata getting very, very hot in the second half when K-State was in trouble. To be fair, it's probably not a close game in the second half if Cardi doesn't turn it over literally five times during West Virginia's 15-0 run to get them back in the game. So it was a little bit of both from Cardi Ejata, but more good than bad for sure. I mean, 8 of 14 from the field is very strong. 4 of 6 from the field, 5 of 7 from the foul line. And Cardi hit a front end of 1-1, I believe, with about 6-7 minutes left in K-State, only up 6. I thought those were pressure free throws, and he made those. He played very, very well. I don't know how much better he played than David Sloan, as silly as that sounds, because Sloan only scored 9 and went 2-7 from the field and 0-1 from the foul line. But he was also 5-6 from the free throw line. David Sloan, that's 83% for a guy who was shooting 40% coming in. Sloan had 5 assists to just 1 turnover on a night where K-State's assist to turnovers were 18-16, basically even for one guy to go 5-1 is pretty impressive and shows how uniquely well he handled that pressure against West Virginia compared to his peers. Also, 4 steals from David Sloan in 36 minutes. If plus minus is something you care about, Sloan was the best on the team at plus 20 in this game. And that seems reasonable to me. I'm not saying he was K-State's best player. It's hard to argue against Cardi Ejata, Xavier Sneed, Dejuan Gordon in this one. David Sloan was really, really big, though. McCall Mawain played his best 10 minutes of the year. I say that somewhat jokingly, but I do mean it. He also found a way to foul out in 10 minutes, but he played incredibly hard, I thought. Grabbed 6 boards in 10 minutes. That's a great rebounding rate against a great West Virginia team, a great front court they have. At one point when K-State had 6 rebounds in the entire game, Mac had 5 of them. So I'm not trying to praise a guy who's a senior starter we expect a ton out, who fouled out in 10 minutes. It's not good enough. He has to play better. But if the steps of rebuilding McCall Mawain are one, playing hard and having energy, he did that on Saturday against West Virginia and did impact the game. Xavier Sneed was very good. 16 points on 4 of 6 shooting, 7 of 10 from the foul line. Also made a key front end of 1-on-1 and then made both shots later in that game to keep K-State in it. Only played 28 minutes with the 3 fouls. Grant Flanders saw him basically tell the coaches he was going back in the game with 2 fouls. Bruce Weber, Chris Lowry, those guys, to their credit, could have stopped him, did not. Chose to put him back in with 2 fouls when K-State was only up 4 points late in the first half. They ended up being up 17 at halftime, a big part of that because of Xavier Sneed. Levi Stockard plays 13 minutes, goes 2 of 2 from the floor for 4 points. He only grabs 1 rebound. He does foul 4 times. He did start in this game just like David Sloan did. A unique starting lineup for K-State: David Sloan, Cardi Ejata, Xavier Sneed, Levi Stockard, McCall Mawain. Levi only played 13 minutes. So the starting 2 posts, Levi and Mac, combined to play just 23 minutes in this game, and K-State beat the number 4 KenPom team in the country, 84-68. Dejuan Gordon, maybe the story of this game: 15 points, 6-7 from the floor, 3 of 4 from 3. He got 3 boards, 2 assists, 4 steals. I believe all those steals, at least 3 of them, came in the first half. He played 28 minutes off the bench. At halftime, Dejuan was 5 of 5 from the floor, 3 of 3 from 3 for 13 points. He was the biggest catalyst in K-State creating a huge cushion at halftime against West Virginia. His best game by far for the true freshman. He was very impressive. I thought Chris Nelson, if you read in the final, kind of wisely noted how much this game reminded him a little bit, at least the first half, of when Barry Brown scored 30 with like 6 steals against Oklahoma State a couple years ago in Bramlage. Of course, Dejuan only gets 15, 4 steals. He didn't do the same thing. He's also just a freshman. I think through a half, it looked like one of those kind of performances. Antonio Gordon kind of silently made an impact in this game. Only had 3 baskets, but they were 2 dunks and a 3 that led him to, you know, blow a kiss to the crowd once again and really put West Virginia away. 3 of 4 from the field. He played 14 minutes. He only grabbed 1 board. He did turn it over twice. He wasn't great in this one, but he made an impact. Montavious Murphy did not start, but played 32 minutes. So you look at those backup posts, Montavious Murphy, Antonio Gordon, 32 and 14. What is that? 46 minutes they played against the 23 played by the starters. So interesting to note. Monty just had 4 points, 4 boards, turned it over 3 times, fouled 4 times. He wasn't great in this one. He took a key charge early in the game that really got the crowd going. He also had a key driving layup late in the first half that put K-State out double digits. So, kind of like Antonio Gordon, he didn't play great for sure, but the minutes he played were impactful. Pearson McAtee also got in the game when it was still in doubt. No real numbers for Pearson McAtee. He played just a minute, but he was inserted into the lineup. No more Mike McGurl again that week on Saturday as he dealt with a concussion. I think he'll be back briefly, but I still don't know exactly when. Post-game was, of course, interesting. Bruce Weber is very happy. Players very happy. You could tell the mood was of a group that really wanted this to happen and had waited a long time for a win like this. As far as what it means, I don't know what it means big picture. If you're somebody who thought this team had given up on his coaching staff, it should change your mind on that. So should have coming back by down 15 against Texas Tech, you know, and taking the lead in the second half should have done that too. So if you thought this program was done and Bruce was done and you gave up on him, that should probably change your mind, I think, a little bit. If you didn't think that, though, and if you were expecting this to be a rough year and were already disappointed with the results, rightfully so, but expected it to continue to be that way, I don't know if that should change your mind either. I don't think this team all of a sudden starts competing in the Big 12 on a regular basis or gets to 500 in the league. I think it doesn't change a lot, but it should show you this is still a capable team when things go well. Talked real briefly, kind of just off the record, with Cartier Jada for 5 or 6 minutes after the game. And that kid is so excited to play in Allen. He was reciting to me all his trips there and how much he didn't play in some of the games he did play. Reciting the finish of that game they lost when he had a big game, I believe as a redshirt freshman there in Allen a couple years ago. He's very, very excited for it. So looking forward to see what he does in that setting as he's really started to score the basketball the last couple of weeks. I think this should about wrap up another edition of KSO Today. If you are listening on our YouTube channel, please take a moment, hit that red button on the bottom right, and subscribe. It really does help us out. I'd ask the same if you're listening on Podbean to subscribe to us there. And especially consider becoming a member at KSET Online if you haven't already. We would sure appreciate your business and hope we would do enough to earn it after you give it to us. So we'll have full coverage from inside of Allen Fieldhouse tomorrow night as K-State looks for a second straight major Big 12 upset. That will wrap up KSO Today. Hope you have a fantastic week.